Hey, Ethan. I understand your dad has a big role in getting these bands to come to Memphis for shows. I'm making a documentary. I was wanting to ask you, why do you think Nashville is getting these bigger musical acts when Memphis is considered this great music city it is? You know?
Yeah, you know, that's a question I've been wondering myself, and I'm sure a lot of Memphians have been wanting to know the same thing. And my guess is that the two cities have kind of been fighting and trying their best to get the best bands they could, and I guess you could call it a battle for the bands. Battle for the bands. A 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 battle for the bands.
Memphis music, blues, rock and roll, soul, jazz, modern meets rural. Musicians shaping the distinctive sounds of American music with such a rich musical legacy. Why has our city, once known as the home of rock and roll and blues, become a city that musicians no longer gravitate to?
At the peak of the 80s, concert tickets were affordable, types of acts and venues were numerous, and people had dispensable income for entertainment. A trade publication for the concert industry named Polestar stated that the average ticket price to the 100 most popular tours in North America has almost quadrupled over the past two decades, from $25.81 in 1996 to a whopping $91.86 through the first half of this year. A man named Bob Kelly, the head promoter with Mid-South Concerts, had a monopoly in booking acts during those early years. Deals were made with cash. Actual booking for the promoters' transactions with acts were scarce, and Kelly was known to book Memphis, Nashville, and other surrounding areas. There would be bands such as The Who, Van Halen, Styx, or AC/DC that you would end up seeing at the Coliseum or the Liberty Bowl. Increased competition between these promoters, booking agents, and venues to draw in these big names kept increasing throughout the years. Venues such as Mud Island and FedEx Forum all have agreements with booking companies. The mecca of concert music in Memphis is the Forum, which will generally get first pick of most of the big tours. Not only must they meet a touring act guarantee, but they want to know there is a space for a huge, humongous profit. If they don't book this show, the acts can't just move on to the next venue in Memphis. A non-complete clause will mean the tour must move on to the next city. This means Memphis loses, skipping out on Memphis, but other cities benefit. This includes cities just past Memphis, including South Haven and Tupelo. And don't forget about the largest beneficiary, Nashville, Tennessee. Grayson recently wanted to open a 5,000 to 10,000 seat venue. It would have been in direct competition with Mud Island. The city touts Mud Island as an intimate venue surrounded by the majestic Mississippi River. On my recent trip to Mud Island, I was shocked with the overall decline in appearance and failure of our city to maintain this venue site. Everything is in disrepair, peeling paint, molding fountains, and more items that make one wonder how we can even sell the option. Graceland ended up opening their 2,000 seat venue. It is in direct competition with Minglewood, which is privately owned. There is also some thought that the city stopped special concert events at some venues like the Liberty Bowl and the AutoZone due to liabilities. 6 years ago, we were considered a C-level market. This rating was how likely a touring act is likely to return to an area after performing there. Many bands were already skipping Memphis on their next tour and heading to Nashville or Little Rock. The public consensus as far back as 10 years ago was that the big name acts were drying up, our musical diversity was declining, and it wasn't unknown to travel to see your favorite act. Memphis was still associated with big name talent, but it was already beginning to morph into something more regional and more local. In 2017, our own local paper acknowledged, saying, "Memphis is a must-stop for any tourist seeking to understand the roots of rock, blues, and soul. But we have not come close to developing a musical economy matching that of Nashville. There is an estimated 20,000 jobs are tied to the industry."
Sadly, most tourists are not coming here exclusively to follow large name music acts. It is interesting to note that when asked, many of those tourist reviews describe the poverty, aggressiveness of panhandlers, and feeling fearful, lack of kid-friendly atmosphere, lack of warmth, and overall failure to maintain establishments and our city surroundings. The Nashville Tourism Board seems to be making a concerted effort to bring the tourists in and want people to know that Nashville is now more than just country music. Not only do the Grand Ole Opry and Ryman Auditorium still have a draw, but the city offers a live music scene 365 days a year. They offer 10 favorite non-country music venues as an option. Even country music superstars are getting in and offering alternative sites for big name acts to perform. Country superstars Brooks and Dunn have recently opened 2 live music locations open year-round. Concert promoters for these Nashville venues seem to have their finger on the pulse. They understand that many millennials have the disposable funds for entertainment and are willing to spend. I was lucky enough to speak with 4 of the biggest names connected with the music concert promotion booking industry in Memphis. Jim Green from Live Nation has worked with Dave Matthews and Eric Church. He uses analytics to track artist popularity and communicates with other promoters and venues in different markets. Paulette Luker has worked for Mid-South Concerts and the Orpheum Theater. Paulette uses a publication called Polestar when a booking is being considered. She acknowledged some of the privately owned venues don't have a chance to grab some of the big-name entertainment due to the non-compete clause. Ron Jewell is the head of operations at the Halloran Center. He says, "I do think that Memphis has a certain idea about it, but ultimately, it's about money and date. No one is making a choice to play Memphis any longer just because it's Memphis." Barry Leff, vice president of Beaver Productions, has worked with Paul McCartney and the Rolling Stones. He deals with national talent agencies. He says, "There is competition between us in Nashville, but it's ultimately the artist's decision. It appears there are some things we could work to improve our chances of drawing big name entertainment back to Memphis, loosening the restrictions by the city of Memphis on the building of new venues, and allowing healthy competition between those venues would be a good place to start. Make room for new companies and new promoters in an area which has been monopolized for far too long. We need to make a concerted effort to renovate and maintain existing facilities which will show big name acts we can compete. The Memphis Board of Tourism needs to review and understand why Nashville is excelling as we lag behind. This would include a look at downtown and overall city safety with elected officials. I don't think it's too late to bring back Memphis to its former glory as a real music town."